Oke, Happy sahabat semua. Sekarang, halo Happy sahabat Nancy.
Halo Nancy, Happy sahabat.
Oke, bisa lihat ini. Ini midnight. Ini Mark 14 verse 53 to 60. Ini apa yang terjadi kepada Tuhan Yesus di waktu midnight. What happened to Jesus at midnight? Right? We know, kita tahu bahwa dia ditangkap. Yeah. Kita tahu dia ditangkap.
Mark
14, 53 to 60. Lalu, apa yang dituduh kepada Tuhan Yesus? Apa yang dia dituduh? What was he accused of when he was captured at midnight? Apa yang dia dituduh oleh orang-orang supaya dia bisa ditangkap? Alright? And they led Jesus away to the high priest. And with him were assembled all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes. Jadi dia dibawa ke high priest. Right? Dibawa oleh, and then ketemu sama chief priest, elders and the scribes. So he basically went to the Jews and to the leaders of the Jewish church. And Peter followed him afar off, jauh-jauh dia, even into the palace of the high priest. And he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. And the chief priests and all the council sought for witness against Jesus to put him to death and found none. Oh, jadi ini chief priest, mereka cari apa? They look for witness. Mereka cari witness itu
saksi.
Mereka cari saksi. They look for witnesses. So somebody that can say something that Jesus did, sesuatu yang Jesus udah bilang atau berbuat dan bisa dipakai supaya dia bisa dihukum mati, right? Tapi mereka nggak dapat. They cannot find any witness. Mereka mau cari witness, nggak ada witness. Okay. For many bear false witness against him, but their witness agreed not together. Lalu mereka akhirnya dapat witness, saksi, tapi saksi yang palsu. Yang problemanya, what was the problem? Their witnesses agreed not together. Jadi, dia punya saksi-saksi, ceritanya lain-lain semua. They have all different stories. Okay? So, when you kalau pergi ke mana? Ke pengadilan, terus saksi-saksinya semua ceritanya lain, wah, rumit juga. It's not gonna happen. Right? Bagaimana kamu bisa di ini? Bagaimana kamu bisa dituduh supaya mau dihukum mati? And there arose certain and bear false witness. Jadi ada false witness against him. Dan bagaimana mereka bisa dapat false witness ini? How did they get the false witness? Bagaimana caranya mereka bisa dapat false witness? Nyonya White sudah bilang sebenarnya. Apa mereka berbuat? Mereka sogok. They were bribed. Right? Disogok. We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another made without hands. Okay? Mereka bilang, kita dengar bahwa dia berkata, saya akan menghancurkan Ka'bah ini yang diperbuat dengan tangan. Dan dalam 3 hari saya akan bangun Ka'bah yang baru, Ka'bah lain yang tidak dibangun dengan tangan. Oke, okay. Ini false witness. Okay. Bukannya Tuhan Yesus pernah bilang ini?
Iya.
Tapi ini false. Jadi apa kesalahannya? What did actually? Ya, jadi apa yang Tuhan Yesus bilang dan kalau ini false, dia bilang ini mereka bilang Tuhan Yesus mau merusakkan ini temple, right? Dan dalam 3 hari dia akan bangun lagi templenya. Neither so did their witness agree together. And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, answer thou nothing? Kamu jawab sesuatu atau tidak? Tapi Tuhan Yesus tidak jawab ya. Jadi, apa yang Tuhan Yesus sebenarnya bilang, yang mereka sudah putar balik? Mereka sudah putar balik. Okay. What did Jesus actually say? This is what Jesus said. Ini apa yang Tuhan Yesus bilang. John 2 verse 19 to 21. Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Did he say, I will destroy this temple? No, he didn't say that. He said, you destroy this temple, and I will raise it up. Ya kan? So, what the false witness said, apa yang saksi-saksi salah, saksi-saksi palsu bilang, bahwa dia bilang dia yang mau hancurkan temple ini. Alright? Padahal Tuhan Yesus tidak bilang itu. Tuhan Yesus bilang, kamu yang mau destroy temple ini, dan saya akan bangkitkan lagi dalam 3 hari. Right? Yeah. Then said the Jews, 46 years was this temple in building. Will thou raise it up in 3 days? And he was talking about the temple of his body. Tapi juga di Leviticus, sudah di Leviticus 21 ayat 12. Sudah dibilang juga, diramalkan bahwa Tuhan Yesus is going to go to temple. Neither shall he go out of the sanctuary, nor profane the sanctuary of his God. Dia tidak akan profane the sanctuary of his God. Profane itu artinya apa? Bahasa Indonesia ini apa itu ya, profane? How do you profane the temple? Profane is what? Ini profane here, right here. Harus lihat dari Alkitab. Bahasa Jewishnya halal. Oh, shalal, halal. Defile, pollute, or desecrate. Or make common. Alright? Profane the temple is when you you defile or... Jadi yang sebenarnya defile the temple ini siapa sebenarnya? It's actually the Jews. What did they do? They were selling and buying inside the temple, right? Mereka jual beli di dalam temple. Mereka yang defile the temple. And what happened? When they were defiling the temple, he is the one that clean it up. So, mereka bilang, oh, ini orang dia yang profane the temple. Karena dia ngomong-ngomong jelek tentang temple. He is the one that talks bad about the church. Dia ini yang mau serang-serang gereja. Okay. Orang-orang di present truth, apakah pernah kamu dituduh itu? Bahwa kamu itu suka serang-serang gereja?
Ya, Uncle.
Waduh. Sering sekali. Itu salah satu, nomor satu tuduhan against present truth. Bahwa kamu itu mau serang-serang gereja. Ya. Remember, ingat, Jesus is our example in everything. Kita akan dituduh menyerang-nyerang gereja. Profanation is when you talk bad about the church. Right? Jadi kamu akan dituduh profanation, nomor satu. Okay, di midnight, tuduhannya ada 3 sebenarnya. Bukan 2, 3. Salah satu adalah, nomor satu, profanation. Okay, profanation. Kamu dituduh serang gereja. Padahal yang menjelek-jelekkan, yang merusakkan temple, yang merusak kebaktian, yang bikin tiada kebaktian, yang menjual beli di dalam gereja, sebenarnya siapa? Spiritual Israel. Mereka yang they actually defile and pollute and desecrate the temple. Right? Israel is doing that, but they actually accuse Jesus of profanation, menjelek-jelekan gereja. Alright. Jadi ingat, ini terjadi. Siapa yang pernah dituduh profanation? Menjelek-jelekan gereja. Siapa lagi? Kira-kira dalam Alkitab, siapa yang dituduh menjelek-jelekan gereja?
Stefanus ya, Kak.
Stefanus, oh bagus. Stefanus. Alright. This is dari Acts of the Apostles, 98.3. Because the priests and rulers would not prevail against the clear, calm wisdom of Stephen. They determined to make an example of him. And while thus satisfying their eventual hatred, they will prevent others through fear and adopting his belief. Wow. Mereka mau intimidate orang-orang lain supaya jangan ikut-ikut Stefanus. Witnesses were hired. Saksi-saksi di hire. Persis kayak Yesus. To bear false testimony that they heard him speak blasphemous words against the temple and the law. Mereka ngomong-ngomong jelek tentang temple and the law. Itu yang dituduh kepada Stephen. That is what Stephen was being accused of. Mereka tuduh dia profanation. Jadi sekarang ngerti ya artinya profanation? Menjelek-jelekan temple. Itu profanation. Padahal sebenarnya aslinya profanation itu desecrate the temple. Desecrate the temple itu orang Jewish sendiri yang padahal mau jual beli di dalam itu, temple. Okay. Siapa juga yang di... lalu kenapa? Ini persis sekali nih. Kenapa dia dilempar batu? Kenapa Stefanus dilempari batu? Why was he stoned? Acts 7, verse 44 to 50. Our fathers had tabernacles of witness in the wilderness, as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses, that he should make it according to the fashion they had seen. Okay? Which also our fathers had come after brought it in with Jesus into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drave out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David. Jadi, Stefanus sedang cerita kepada mereka bagaimana tempelnya Musa itu dibawa dari padang belantara dan dibangun oleh David. Alright? Who found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle before the God of Jacob. But Solomon built him a house. Tapi bukan David yang boleh bangun, tapi Solomon. Howbeit, bagaimana the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands. As saith the prophet, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. And what house will ye build me, said the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Jadi dia bilang sekarang. Stefanus dibilang. Dia bilang kepada Tuhan itu tidak berada di dalam gereja yang dibangun dengan tangan manusia. Kenapa? Because the temple service is over. Temple on earth is over. Karena antitype sudah datang, kan? Jadi sekarang temple-nya di mana? Kalau bukan di dalam gedung. Where's the temple now? It's in a temple that is not made with man's hands. Jadi itu temple yang dibuat bukan dengan tangan manusia. Yang temple yang dibangun dengan tangannya Tuhan. Jadi temple itu apa? Which temple is that? That's you and me. That's the temple. Yeah. That is the temple. Because the Most High dwelleth not dulu waktu di zamannya Musa, he dwells in the temple, in the structure. After Jesus came, he no longer dwelleth in temples made with man's hands. Yeah. Wow. Ini berat juga ini. Apa artinya? Apa masih berlaku untuk kita sekarang ini? Apakah itu masih berlaku untuk kita?
Masih, Kak.
Iya, masih. When Stephen reached this point, waktu Stefanus sampai di saat itu ya, di mana dibilang, oh, temple kamu itu, temple yang di Jerusalem itu, dia istilahnya dia bilang ya, temple kamu yang di Jerusalem itu, Tuhan Yesus tidak, Jesus is not in that temple. Yeah, structure, Jesus is not in the structure. Right? Waktu Stefanus bilang itu, apa terjadi? There was a tumult among the people. When he connected Christ with the prophecies and spoke as he did of the temple. And he spoke as he did of the temple. What was he doing? Dia lagi bikin apa ini? Dia ngomong apa ini? What was he doing? He was profanation. He was committing profanation. Bagi orang-orang Jewish, dia commit profanation. Karena dia ngomong, dia bilang, oh Tuhan Yesus tidak berbakti di dalam temple yang dibangun oleh tangan. He says, Jesus does not, the Most High does not dwell in temples made with man's hands. Right? Mereka marah. Alright? The priest, pretending to be horror-stricken, rent his robe. Rent his robe. Hebat sekali. Apakah priest itu boleh rent his robe? Bukannya di Leviticus dibilang priest itu nggak pernah boleh rent his robe, nggak pernah boleh dirobekin dia punya baju. Priest itu nggak pernah boleh dirobek bajunya. Jadi mereka ini apa di sini? Wah, ini priest sendiri yang lagi berdosa di sini. Alright, to Stephen this act was a signal that his voice would soon be silenced forever. Ini Stephen mengerti bahwa dia kalau ngomong jelek kepada gereja, itu hukuman mati buat dia. Jadi dia habis itu dilempari batu. Alright? And he was stoned. And the reason for it is because of profanation. Alright? Udah ngerti profanation sekarang? And this is what they're gonna accuse you of. And they're gonna wanna kill you for it. Okay. Okay, bagaimana dengan Tuhan Yesus? What happened to him after he went to? Now he goes to Caiaphas. But he held his peace and said nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said, Mark 14, verse 61 to 40, 64. Art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? Apakah kamu Messiah? Christ itu kan Kristus. Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed? Apakah kamu Son? And Jesus said, I am. And ye shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power, coming in the clouds of heaven. Dan dia bilang, kamu nanti akan dibangkitkan sebelum saya datang. Right? You are going to be resurrected before I come. You are going to go through a special resurrection because you're going to see me come. Then their high priest rent his clothes and said, what need ye any further witness? Ye have heard the blasphemy. Okay. Apa perbedaannya blasphemy dengan profanation? Apakah yang blasphemy? Apa perbedaannya blasphemy sama profanation? Ya, ini nomor, ya. Jadi ini accusation yang nomor dua, ya. The first accusation is profanation. What's the second accusation?
Blasphemy.
Okay. Blasphemy, kenapa dia blasphemy? You know, what's apa, you know, kalau profanation itu ngomong jelek tentang gereja. Alright? Kalau blasphemy, apakah ngomong jelek tentang gereja itu blasphemy? No, that's profanation. Jadi, blasphemy itu apa? What is blasphemy then?
Menghujat nama apa Tuhan ya? More that to God instead of the temple.
Yes, so you're actually questioning the sonship of God. The sonship of Jesus. All right? Di sini bilang, kamu ini Kamu mengaku kamu anak Allah. You're saying that you're the son of God. Alright? Padahal mereka itu, sebenarnya mereka nggak percaya bahwa manusia ini, you know, that this man, see this, Caiaphas is looking at him and goes, you're a man. How could you claim yourself to be the son of God? If you're saying you're the son of God has equal divinity of the Father. The Jews believe that. Alright? Orang-orang Jewish itu percaya bahwa anak Allah punya divinity sama dengan Allah Bapa. Jadi, kalau manusia ini bilang dia anak Allah, dia itu mengaku dia punya divinity sama dengan, dia mempunyai divinity dan mempunyai divinity yang sama dengan Bapa. Alright? So if he is actually claiming that he is the Messiah, this man here, what is it? He has the same divinity as the Father. Okay? And to them, that is blasphemy. Right? If you claim that you have the divinity of the Father. All right. Okay. Jadi pertanyaan saya, ini yang gampang ya. Kalau kita akan di midnight, kita akan ditangkap dan dituduh profanation, itu gampang ya. That's easy. Sedangkan sekarang aja kita dituduh profanation. Alright. Bagaimana waktu kita midnight, kita dituduh blasphemy? Kira-kira bagaimana kita akan dituduh blasphemy? Lihat yang dari ini. Contohnya di Tuhan Yesus. Bagaimana kita akan dituduh blasphemy? Dan oleh siapa?
Mengenai Trinitas ya, Kara.
Iya, jadi tapi spesifiknya apa? Apa? Spesifiknya apa? Lihat ini dari Tuhan Yesus. Specifically apa yang dituduh? Dan bilang, oh, karena kamu percaya ini, kamu udah blasphemy. Apa kira-kira?
Spesifik mengenai Roh Suci.
Oh, enggak. Ini enggak ada ngomong tentang Roh Suci di sini. Ini tentang anak, the sonship.
Oh.
About the sonship. Okay? The son of God. Okay? Jadi gini, kamu punya kepercayaan tentang anak Allah akan membuat kamu dituduh blasphemy. Oke. Okay. Bagaimana kira-kira kamu punya kepercayaan tentang anak Allah itu akan membuat sampai spiritual Israel akan menuduh kamu blasphemy? Kira-kira gimana?
Karena kita nggak percaya ko-eternal dengan Bapa ya.
That's true. Karena kita tidak percaya bahwa dia itu God the Son. We don't believe. Do you believe that he is God the Son? No, we believe that he is the Son of God. So, God the Son, Allah anak itu beda sama anak Allah. Ngerti? Oh, coba besar bedanya. There's a big difference. Bisa ngerti? Kalau Allah, apa bedanya Allah anak sama anak Allah? Apa bedanya Allah anak sama anak Allah? Apa bedanya Allah anak? Nomor satu ya, the biggest one is, tidak ada satu pun ayat di dalam Alkitab yang bilang dia itu Allah anak. Tidak ada satu pun ayat yang bilang dia Allah anak. Oke? Dan semuanya dibilang, semuanya dia itu anak Allah. Tidak ada satu pun ayat yang dibilang di Alkitab bahwa dia itu Allah anak. Alright? The Father is, you know, God the Father. Tapi tidak ada yang bilang God the Son. Karena dia itu tidak co-eternal. Dia equal dalam divinity, tapi dia enggak co-eternal. He is not the eternal God. Siapa yang eternal God? God the Father.
Bapa.
Yeah. Apakah Yesus itu God the Son?
Enggak. Son of God.
He's the Son of God. Kenapa dia bukan God the Son nomor satu? Karena tidak dibilang di Alkitab. It's not in the Bible. Okay, itu nomor satu. Right? Tapi nomor duanya juga karena kita ngerti bahwa He is the Son of God karena dia benar-benar eser komai. Dia itu memang betul-betul the Son. He is not co-eternal. But He has the same divinity. Okay. Jadi, kira-kira kamu akan dianggap dituduh blasphemy. Are you going to be accused blasphemy because you teach 2520? Enggak. Mereka pun enggak ngerti 2520 ini bagaimana mereka mau ini. Mau menuduh kamu blasphemy. Apakah kamu itu dituduh blasphemy karena kamu percaya perfection? No. Kamu dianggap blasphemy karena kamu punya your understanding of the sonship, the Son of God. Okay? Your understanding of the Son of God, kamu punya pengertian who the Son of God is going to be different. It's going to be 100% opposite to what spiritual Israel believes, and spiritual Israel is going to persecute you because of that. Right? Ngerti ya? Oke, okay. Ada lagi? Udah ngerti sekarang? Natanya udah ngerti perbedaannya God the Son and the Son of God? Anak Allah dengan Allah anak?
Ngerti, Uncle.
Ngerti kan?
Jadi, yeah. Allah anak, Tuhan Yesus, co-eternal ya?
Iya, yeah, co-eternal. Allah anak Allah. Karena dia itu dari sekarang udah tiga Allah. Allah Bapa, Allah anak, dan Allah Roh Kudus. Tiga Allah itu menjadi satu. Tiga Allah menjadi satu. Oke. Di 28 Fundamentals, diajarnya apa? Kita percaya Allah Bapa, Allah Anak, dan Allah Roh Kudus. Dan tiga-tiganya itu adalah satu. Itu di mana? Di 28 Fundamentals. Jadi ini yang akan membuat kamu dianiaya nanti.
Boleh bertanya?
Oh iya iya. Oke, okay, Bu.
Jadi kembali lagi, jadi kita punya kita punya belief yang mana? Ada berapa God? Satu, dua, atau tiga?
We believe in one eternal God. But Jesus is God because He is the Son of God. But He is not the eternal God. The eternal God is God the Father. But Jesus is the Son of God. And because of His He has the same divinity that he inherited from God the Father. He is also called God. But we believe, we have a monotheistic belief. We have the same belief as Abraham. And it is all monotheistic. It's God, we believe in God the Father. Right? Jadi, and then and the Son of God.
Kalau bedanya being sama God di situ apa?
Oh ya, yeah, they're both beings.
Ya, yeah, jadi two being sama two gods lain. Kan tadi bilang one God, which is the eternal God, the Father, dan dia punya anak adalah Son of God, which is God also.
He is He is
God dan anak Allah.
So this is the biggest difference, that it has to settle in your mind. It has to settle that God the Father is the God. He is the Ancient of Days. He is the Eternal God. Di dalam Alkitab tidak ada yang dibilang Eternal God kecuali the Father. He is the Eternal God. He is the only Ancient of Days, and He is the Father. And He is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Betul, itu betul. Kalau itu yang memang kita percaya juga, yang saya percaya. Tapi yang waktu dibilang ada dua being, itu yang saya jadi nggak ngerti. Karena kalau bilang satu God, which is the eternal God, dan dia punya anak adalah Son of God. Dan di Filipi 2 ayat 6, dia bilang dia punya form of God, that not robbery to be equal with God. Ya kan? Jadi, itulah yang saya percaya juga. Sebenarnya, satu God. Dan ada Son of God, which is anak.
Anak Allah. The thing is, that what when you say that Jesus is God, you're talking about His divinity. That is Godhead. This divinity, that's you're talking about His divinity, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That's the reason why He is God, because He has the same divinity. That's why inilah yang paling, you know, that's what, you know, that's what that He settled. Have to settle that what His divinity is, why He is God, but He is not the God. God itu, because we are also gods. You know, I am a God, because it means if I am superior to somebody else, I am His God. Itu kena, because Moses was the God of Pharaoh.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, God being the superior is also a description, but when it becomes a noun where He is the God, no, there's only one noun that is the God. So, but Jesus is God. That's a description of His divinity, right? That's the description. So that is why there's only one God. So yeah. When Jesus is the Son of God, we know. Oh, okay, we will know it. But Jesus is God, because that is a description of His divinity.
Yeah. Yeah, betul. Berarti memang karena yang di Bible itu selalu dibilang-bilang cuma one, ya kan? Yeah. One God, which is the eternal God, which is the Father, the source of everything.
Right. And makanya kita ini, I am a God. I am a God to all the nurses in the hospital. Right? Because Moses is the God to Pharaoh. Because I am, so a God means, you know, you're the you know, you're the superior to the what, you know, the what. It is a description of your, you know, for God it is, for divinity it's, you know, different, you know, but for humans it can also be gods. So yeah, God is a description also. It is also the description of the divinity of that what, right?
Kalau Musa memang karena God sendiri yang bilang.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Ya kan, jadi memang God sendiri yang bilang, kamu saya bikin menjadi God, ya kan?
But He is not God. He's not the God.
He's not the God. Yeah, betul. Yeah.
But He is a God.
Yep.
So those kind of things, you know, is very important, because this is what we're going to be tested on. This is going to come out at midnight. Your understanding is going to be 180 degrees difference from what spiritual Israel believes, and you are going to be accused of blasphemy. Ooh, all right. But can they hang you? Can they put you in prison for blasphemy? Of course not. Yeah. Nggak bisa, ya. Okay. Ini di 3SP, 3 Spirit of Prophecy 119.3. The High Priest raised his right hand toward heaven in the most imposing manner, with a solemn voice addressed Jesus, I adjure thee by the living God that thou tell us whether thou be the Christ, the Son of God. And then what did he say? Thou hast said it. Bahasa Ibraninya, selalu bahasa Hebrew, if they answer thou hast said it, means yes, that is what it means. All right? Dan di sini diuji. Kayafas istilahnya. Kayafas karena dia tidak mengerti, he just condemned himself. Right? So your understanding who your God is will condemn you. Wow. Kayafas, by his understanding of who God is, just condemned himself. You know, this is such an awesome responsibility. You have to know your God. If you don't know your God, you are going to condemn yourself. Yeah, the God you worship, right? So I said, well, I don't know God, you know. Well, if you don't know God, you're going to have the same problem with Caiaphas. Pretty amazing.
Yeah, at the end juga also kita akan disebut sebagai anak-anak Allah. Yes, ya kan? Yes. Karena kita karena kita serve God yang tidak kelihatan. Ya kan? Kita tahu ada God karena ada Bible. Ya kan? Tetapi makanya di Christ Object Lesson itulah waktu karakter Kristus itu terpantul, bisa dilihat, bahkan dia akan datang. Jadi waktu ada orang-orang yang berjalan seperti Kristus waktu dia di dunia, itulah yang akan dia sebut nanti sebagai Son of God juga.
Iya. Yang hebatnya ya, ya mereka langsung lihat ya. You know, in our end time, people will actually have to see Christ walking around because we have the character of Christ. Betul?
Betul, betul sekali.
Yeah. So basically they're seeing Christ walking around and they see the character of Christ in us, right? Karena kita memantulkan yang kayak Glenn bilang. Betul? All right. Tapi mereka enggak percaya. Right? That's going to be a problem. Mereka enggak percaya. Ah, kamu ini. You know, as a matter of fact, they said, "Oh, you holier than thou." Kamu itu kayak sok suci.
Ya. Ya, makanya kita akan di-treat sama sebagaimana Kristus di persecute, kita juga akan di-persecute seperti itu. Karena kita menghidupkan kehidupan karakter daripada Tuhan. Gitu kan?
Karena istilahnya mereka bilang, kamu sok suci.
Itu dia.
Padahal mereka itu juga lihat, Yesus di depan mereka itu bilang, istilahnya mereka bilang, Tuhan Yesus, ah, kamu ini sok suci. Kamu bilang, kamu ini adalah sama, you say you're the Son of God, meaning you're equal with God, meaning you're, you know, you're a divinity, you know, kamu bilang kamu suci. You know, something like that. It's the same thing. Yeah. Okay. And it's sama. It's exactly happening the same time again. All right. Jadi ini ya, apa? 3SP 120.1. The divinity of Christ flashed through this guise of humanity. And the high priest quailed before the penetrating eyes of the Savior. All right. That look seemed to read his hidden thoughts and burn into his heart, and never in afterlife did he forget that searching glance of the persecuted Son of God. Right? This voluntary confession of Jesus claiming the sonship with God. Ini prinsipnya di sini, the sonship. This is the sonship. This is what is going to cause you to be accused of blasphemy. Ini yang akan memperbuat kamu percaya, punya kepercayaan ini yang akan memperbuat kamu dituduh blasphemy. Dan istilahnya, kamu dituduh blasphemy juga, Amerika sama sekali benci kamu karena kamu sudah bisa memantulkan karakter Yesus. Yeah. Yeah. All right. The Lord of life and glory would be seated to the at the right hand. Okay. All right. Okay. Jesus knew that would be the result of this announcement, that it would secure his condemnation. Ah, dia bilang ini, karena dia sudah mengaku itu, dia sudah mengaku siapa dia, akan membuat dia dituduh dan akhirnya dikondem untuk mati. Right? Jesus had declared himself to be the Christ, and because of this, he's accused of blasphemy. All right. Okay. All right, ini 3SP 120.2. All right. Okay. Ah, sekarang yang nomor tiga. What is penuduhan nomor tiga? All right. Number one is profanation. Profanation kita tahu itu ngomong jelek tentang gereja. Nomor dua adalah blasphemy. tentang kamu punya, they question your belief in the son, in the of the Christ sonship. All right. The charge of blasphemy would be regarded by Pilate as an expression of religious bigotry and priestly jealousy. Ah, blasphemy ini bagi kita tidak berlaku buat orang-orang Rome. Ya benar, ini enggak berlaku. Ini hanya kamu punya problem saja. Kamu punya problem antara kamu sendiri, punya pertentangan, kamu punya jealousy, kamu punya bigotry, kamu punya bigotry ya. Bigotry itu bahasa Indonesia. Bigotry, what is bigotry? It's when you accuse other people of not having the same beliefs as you have, you know? Itu bigotry. Okay.
Kefanatikan.
Oh, I don't think it's kefanatikan. All right, anyway. But if they could excite the apprehensions of the Roman governor that Jesus was a leader of sedition. Ini nomor tiga. What is tuduhan nomor tiga? Di midnight? Nomor tiga apa? Sedition. Okay, sedition itu apa? What is sedition? Sedition itu apa? What is sedition? Kita udah tahu nomor satu dan dua. Nomor tiga, sini sedition. Apa itu sedition? Right? Istilahnya, sedition itu supaya ada sesuatu yang bisa membuat Tuhan Yesus bisa dihukum dengan hukum Rom. Right? Dan dia harus dituduh sedition. Apa sedition? Apa sedition? What is sedition? Luke 23, verse 18 to 25. And they cried out all at once, saying, away with this man, and release unto us Barabbas, who for a certain sedition made in the city for murder and cast into prison. Hey, mereka menuduh Yesus membuat sedition, padahal siapa yang sebenarnya membuat sedition? Barabbas, right? So, seditionnya apa ini? What kind of sedition did Barabbas do? Enggak. Bukan cuma melanggar hukum. What ini sedition apa ini? Jadi
menghasut ya kak ya.
Ya.
Menghasut.
Ya, menghasut kepada negara ya. Menghasut mau membuat pemberontakan gitu kepada negara. Menghasut orang supaya membuat pemberontakan kepada negara. Nah, itu sedition. Penghasut.
Sama dengan
apa?
Provokasi.
Provokasi. Yeah. Pilate therefore willing to release Jesus, speak again to them, but they cried, crucify him. Okay. And Pilate gave sentence that it should be as they required. And he released, unto them him that for sedition and murder was cast into prison. Jadi itu Barabbas membuat sedition dan membunuh. Justru dia yang dilepasin dan Yesus yang dikasih masuk, ya, yang dibunuh mati. Ya. Justru mereka yang dia yang sebenarnya buat sedition, dia justru yang dilepasin. Istilahnya orang Israel yang membuat sebenarnya profanation, mereka yang defile temple, padahal mereka yang menuduh Tuhan Yesus. Profanation. Nah, Barabbas yang membuat sedition, membuat penghasutan untuk melawan kepada negara Rom, malah dia yang dilepasin, Tuhan Yesus yang dikasih masuk. Dikasih masuk ke mana? Masuk supaya dibunuh. The Roman authorities at that time held a prisoner named Barabbas. Desire of Ages 33.1. They held a prisoner named Barabbas, who was under sentence of death. Oh, dia sedang dihukum mati. This man had claimed to be the Messiah. Dia ini, he's a false Messiah. Dia bilang dia Messiah. Waduh. Tuhan Yesus juga bilang dia Messiah. He claimed authority to establish a different order of things, to set the world right. Oh. Dia mau bikin order yang baru katanya. He wants to set a new world order. Under satanic delusion, he claimed that whatever he could obtain by theft and robbery was his own. Wow. Jadi kalau dia mencuri, dia bisa claim buat dirinya sendiri. He had done wonderful things through satanic agencies. He had gained a following among the people and excited sedition against the Roman government. It's a rebellious enthusiasm to cause sedition against the Roman government. Jadi dia menghasut orang supaya berontak melawan negara Rom. Ya. Nah, inilah yang menghasut. Jadi remember, tiga ya. Profanation, blasphemy, and sedition. Dan itu rentetannya begitu. Harus berentetnya begitu. Yeah, that has to be the sequence, okay? The sequence-nya harus begitu. Alright. Siapa lain juga yang dituduh sedition? Ini siapa ini? Paul. Acts 24 ayat 1, 5, dan 6. And after 5 days, Ananias the high priest descended with elders and with a certain orator, Tertullus, who informed the governor against Paul. Oh, mereka menuduh Paul. For we have found this man a pestilent fellow, a mover of sedition among all the Jews through the world, and a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. Dia ini membuat satu sect, ya. Dia membuat satu aliran. Dia membuat aliran, ya. Dan dia pemimpin. Dan ini dia mau bikin apa? Dia mau bikin sedition, ke pemberontakan ke Rome, right? Dan juga Paul dituduh apa? Who has gone about to profane the temple. Paul juga profanation against the temple. Ngomongin jelek tentang temple. Alright. Jadi Paul juga, nasibnya Paul sama dengan Tuhan Yesus. Ya mirip lah, at least dua lah dia di ini. And the Jews brought against Paul the old charges of sedition and heresy. Acts of the Apostles 4:94.2. And Jews brought against Paul the old charges of sedition and heresy. And both Jews and Romans accused him of instigating the burning of the city. Oh, dia bilang, kamu mau membakar kota Rome. You're trying to go against the Roman government. Yeah? Jadi sedition. Heresy itu kayak apostasy. Heresy, ajaran-ajaran yang ajaran-ajaran palsu. Mereka mengajar ajaran-ajaran palsu. Okay. Ada juga terjadi di zamannya, Zerubbabel. Okay. Ini salah satu yang penting ini, kita tahu ini. Ada juga terjadi di zaman Zerubbabel, waktu mereka kembali dari Babylon, when they went back from Babylon, and they went back to Jerusalem, and they wanted to build a temple. So they were building a temple, but there were people who were against them. Sorry, people who were against them, who did not want them to build the temple. Okay, ada musuh-musuh yang mau mereka berhenti. Alright? Berhenti membangun temple. Okay? Dan yang, who was the king that sent Zerubbabel to build the temple? Siapa raja Medo-Persia yang mengirim Zerubbabel untuk membangun temple? Siapa rajanya?
Cyrus.
Huh? Cyrus atau Darius? Cyrus, right? Bilangnya tadi apa? Cyrus, ya?
Cyrus, Anton.
Okay, betul. Cyrus. Okay, Cyrus sent it. Alright? This is the copy of... Lalu, ini saya nggak usah baca semuanya, tapi saya bikin, ya. Alright? I'm going to tell you the story. Dia, what happened is that now they said, okay, you know, these people, they're the enemies of Zerubbabel said, you know what? These people should stop building the temple, all right? Building the temple. You know what? Because of why? All right. Be it known unto the king that the Jews which came up from thee to us are coming to Jerusalem. Oh ya, raja. Ini mereka tulis kepada raja ya. Ini yang hebatnya dia tulis kepada Artaxerxes, oke? Jadi Artaxerxes padahal bukan raja pada waktu itu. Right? Tapi Artaxerxes itu juga nama satu julukan raja Medo-Persia. Karena pada saat itu bukan raja Artaxerxes. Pada saat itu rajanya di sana namanya Falsmerdis. Right? Ingat Falsmerdis? Falsmerdis itu jadi Cyrus, habis itu Cambyses, habis itu Falsmerdis. Falsmerdis ini sebenarnya penyamar. Ya, yeah, he was actually somebody who pretended to be the king, the brother of Cambyses. He pretended to be Smerdis, but he's actually not Smerdis. Right? Okay. Be it known unto the king that the Jews which came up from thee to us are come unto Jerusalem, building the rebellious and bad city. Oh, mereka bikin kota yang jahat. And have set up the walls and joined the foundations. Be it known now unto the king that if this city was builded and the walls set up again, will they not pay toll, tribute, and custom, and so that they should endamage the revenue of the kings? Oh, okay. Mereka ini lagi bangun Ka'bah. Tapi Ka'bahnya mereka ini kotanya nggak bagus. Ka'bahnya, you know, it's not built. And kalau mereka bangun Ka'bah ini, mereka tidak akan bayar apa? Pajak. Okay? Mereka tidak membayar pajak. Okay. Now, because we have maintenance from the king's palace. Oh, karena kita ini orang bayaran dari palace, dari raja. And it was not meet for us to see the king's dishonor. Jadi kita nggak mau kamu itu di tidak dihormati. Therefore, have we sent and certified the king? Jadi kita kirim surat ini yang disertify kepada raja. The search may be made in the book of the records of thy fathers. So shall thou find in the book of the records and know that this city is a rebellious city and hurtful unto the king and the provinces. Karena mereka ini nggak membayar pajak. Akan membuat kerajaan jadi merugikan, akan merugikan negara. And they have moved apa? Sedition. Jadi sedition yang mereka perbuat bukan hanya menghasut untuk rebellion, tetapi dianggap tidak bayar pajak. Alright, within the same old time. Jadi harus diberhentikan. Jadi Artaxerxes pada zamannya Artaxerxes dia berhentikan itu pembangunan Ka'bah. Karena orang-orang di Yerusalem, karena orang-orang pengikutnya Zerubbabel, because they were accused of avoiding to pay tax. Okay. Jadi kita lihat sini. Zaman kita yang akan problemnya untuk kita dituduh sedition, penghasut kepada negara adalah dalam pembayaran pajak. Alright, ini semua kita lihat dari kita dibikin mau menghasut, bikin kayak aliran sendiri yang mau menjatuhkan negara, tapi juga dengan pembayaran pajak. Jadi ya, so this is what we gonna know. Ini semua maksudnya istilahnya kita lihat semua yang membuat sedition. Karena semua cerita-cerita ini semua is line upon line ya, semuanya line upon line. Jadi satu cerita di atas cerita yang lain, di atas cerita yang satu, di atas cerita yang satu, kita bisa tahu apa yang terjadi di midnight. Okay. All right. Coba sini saya nomor berapa ini ya. All right. Okay. Oh, okay. Ini, alright. Ini masih sama sih. This is actually the same thing. The same thing. Alright. And I commanded, and search has been made, and it's found that this city of old time has made insurrection against kings, and that rebellion and sedition has been made therein. There have been mighty kings also over Jerusalem, which have ruled over all countries beyond the river, and toll, tribute, and custom was paid unto them. Give ye now commandment to cause these men to cease, and this city not to be built until another commandment shall be given from me. Okay. Jadi, rebellion and sedition. Jadi, buat kita yang tinggal di Amerika, how are they going to chase us and say that we can be put to jail? It's for tax evasion. Yeah, that's going to be. Lalu dia punya ini, kota pembangunannya berhenti sampai Darius, the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So, jadi waktu zamannya false Medes, berhenti kerja. Nanti harus ada decree yang keluar dari Darius, baru bisa diselesaikan. Okay? Jadi, yang nomor satu dari Cyrus untuk membangun. Okay? Habis itu berhenti di false Medes. Lalu, supaya meneruskan, nanti harus ada decree lagi yang keluar dari Darius. Alright. Jadi kita lihat ini, Cyrus, Cambyses, false Medes. Ini false Medes, dia yang suruh berhenti. Suruh berhenti pekerjaan. Jadi, yang meneruskan adalah Darius. Lalu kita tahu Xerxes ini siapa? Xerxes adalah Ahasuerus. Ya. Kalau ini Raja Darius ini dia. This is King Darius. Ini batu ini masih ada sampai sekarang di Iran. Oh enggak, di Iran. Namanya Behistun. Ini gunungnya. Dan sampai sekarang masih ada. Ini ya. Dan mereka membuktikan bahwa cerita Darius, false Medes, Cambyses, Cyrus itu semua betul. Ada. Di sini ini membuktikan bahwa cerita itu memang betul. Hebat sekali. That's actually true. Alright. Okay. Ada pertanyaan? Anything? Any questions? Any comments?
Question, Ralph, on the di zaman kita akan dituduh sedition di dalam pembayaran pajak. Can you tell us more about that? How are they going to chase us for tax? Because, I mean, we're all paying tax.
Yeah. Waduh, saya nggak tahu nih tepatnya bagaimana ya. I'm really not sure. Tapi yang for sure-nya, jangan sampai kita pancing-pancing lah, itu for sure. Tapi mereka mungkin akan bikin, they're gonna find something somehow. They're gonna find something somehow to try to get you with your taxes. Somehow, saya nggak tahu ya. Tapi ya mungkin Tuhan udah kasih tahu melalui cerita-cerita di Alkitab begini, bagaimana. You know, it's gonna be something to do with taxes. Jadi, nomor satu adalah, ya, jadi kalau saya lihat-lihat ini juga memang cocok ya kalau kita semua udah, you know, we don't have any mortgages, we don't have to pay all our, you know, property taxes. Sedikit-sedikitnya kita utang-utang tax itu is the probably yang the most beneficial in the end time, you know. You know what I'm saying? Ini saya cuma spekulasi aja ya.
Yeah.
Tapi sedikit-sedikitnya kita punya pertanggungan jawab tax. Bayangin kalau kita punya pertanggungan jawab taxnya, if we have a lot of tax obligation, ya. If we have a lot of companies, we have a lot of, you know, mortgages, and we have a lot of taxes that we are, and things come to all kinds of turmoil during that time, we we may have issues trying to pay our obligations. It's going to be easy for them to chase us with taxes.
Mm.
Itu yang udah pasti sih. Karena memang udah. Tapi bagaimana untuk orang-orang yang sedikit sekali teksnya atau nggak ada, atau kita udah bayar ke depan supaya nggak usah. You know, I'm not sure. Okay. Tapi, you know, something like this memang udah dikasih tahu. You know, it's God in His mercy has told us to make sure you don't get into too much tax debt, so because make it much easier for them to chase you.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that's a good question, then. Yeah. Saya juga belum terlalu tahu, no, mikir-mikir begini. How are they going to chase us with taxes? Okay. Oh, siapa juga? Ada lagi.
When you mentioned about taxes, I was thinking about 501c3.
But we know for sure we're not in 501c3.
Right, but yeah.
Tapi itu mereka yang sudah 501c3, they're stuck.
Right.
Yeah.
Yang apa ya? 501c3.
501c3 ini gini, Nen. 501c3 is the tax exemption code for religious organizations, so that they can accept tax, they can receive tax donation, and those tax donations can be tax deductible for those who donate, because they're donating to a 501c3 entity, nonprofit. But the problem is that 501c3 organizations is actually restricted on what they can and cannot do. In other words, they cannot discriminate against religion, gender, and you know, sexual orientation and all this. So your employees, if you have a 501c3, your employees, you know, status is actually protected by the government. Jadi kalau kamu punya 501c3, jadi di Amerika ini punya 501c3 ini kamu punya status sebagai organisasi, bisa diberikan sumbangan, dan sumbangan yang kamu dikasih itu kamu tidak usah bayar pajak. Jadi kalau saya bayar, saya punya perpuluhan kepada gereja, gereja itu punya status 501c3, saya punya perpuluhan itu, saya bisa hitung mengurangi saya punya pajak. Nah, di situ hanya problemanya di Amerika sekarang, bahwa semua yang mempunyai 501c3 itu harus mengikut undang-undang Amerika. Undang-undang Amerika itu bilang kamu tidak boleh diskriminasi berdasarkan agama, gender, sexual orientation. Yeah. Jadi kalau ada orang yang mau melamar ke kamu punya organisasi, dan dia itu homoseksual, dan dia mau jadi pemimpin di gereja kamu, kamu tidak boleh, karena 501c3 itu di bawah negara punya undang-undang. So you cannot discriminate. That's going to be a problem. Because now, if the government says, you know, we have now a Sunday law, and you still have a 501c3, you have to follow the Sunday law. Dan problemanya, kalau kamu mencabut kamu punya 501c3, kamu punya utang-utang, kamu punya sumbangan-sumbangan yang kamu terima sudah bertahun-tahun begitu, sekarang kamu harus dipajak.
Wow.
Itu bahaya sekali. Kalau tadinya kamu 501c3, terus tiba-tiba kamu nggak mau lagi 501c3, jadi itu bahaya. That's a very big problem.
Ya, jadi banyak yang terjebak dengan kayak non-profit organization kayak gitu yang mereka ini itu. Nah, itu padahal dijebak.
Sebenarnya dijebak.
Iya, sebenarnya gereja apa kayak gitu, ada peraturannya, memang mereka itu nggak perlu ikut itu, memang otomatis dapat apa yang kayak bayar tithe kayak begitu. Ya. Tapi karena mereka ikut non-profit organization itu, jadi terjebak dengan kayak nanti harus ikut mereka punya itu peraturan lah.
Gladys, Gladys juga ada. Gladys, Gladys mau kasih tahu tentang 501c3. Gladys gimana? Oh nanti ya.
Yeah, well for some reason I cannot share. Just okay, just wanna.
Okay, nanti bisa ya, nanti bisa.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, nanti no problem. Jadi Gladys ada. Yeah, but 501c3 is a it could be a big issue karena 501c3 itu bisa juga dipakai untuk control your, it can be used to control your entity. Yeah? Okay. Alright, Martin Luther, ini dari Great Controversy, page 146-147. Martin Luther itu mau diexcommunicate, mau ditendang keluar dari gereja karena dianggap sedition, rebellion, impiety, and blasphemy. Martin Luther juga, yeah, Great Controversy. Okay, alright, okay. Jadi kita udah lihat ya. Saya mau lengkap. Waduh, saya mau lengkap jauh ke Josiah Litch. Karena Josiah Litch ini membuat prediction. Yang hebatnya, Josiah Litch itu kalau kita lihat line upon line, membuat prediction-nya kapan? Midnight. You know, Josiah Litch makes a prediction at midnight. Jadi, apa yang terjadi midnight? Midnight, ada yang ditangkap, dan yang ditangkap itu dituduh profanation, blasphemy, and sedition. Okay. Yang, the issue is, waktu Paul ditangkap, dan dituduh sedition and profanation, ya. Yeah? Apakah Paul takut atau dia senang bahwa dia ditangkap? Ini kita udah belajar ini di sekolah Sabat tahun 18 berapa ya? In our Sabbath school we were studying about this when we studied the book of Acts dari sekolah Sabatnya zaman-zamannya Nyonya White. Paul itu senang justru karena dia tahu dia akan harus ditangkap. He knows that he has to be captured. Kenapa dia senang? Dia bilang, I have to, you know, dia senang. Bahasanya saya lupa ya, but you know, I count it as a blessing that I am actually arrested. It for diverse temptation or something like that. I can't remember. I count it a blessing. Jadi dia menganggap blessing. Kenapa dia menganggap blessing waktu dia ditangkap? Nah, ini pelajaran buat kita juga. Karena waktu kita ditangkap, apakah kita takut waktu kita ditangkap? Atau kita menganggap blessing? Because we get this from Paul. Yeah? Dia bilang dia count it as blessing. Why? Because that is the only way that Nero can hear of the gospel. Yeah? That is the way. Jadi istilahnya supaya gospelnya cepat bisa dibawa ke raja dan orang-orang atas, the higher politicians, is for you to be arrested. Jadi kamu akan ditangkap. Dituduh ini semua, tapi ini justru jalan Tuhan supaya kamu membawa gospel kepada raja-raja, kepada pemerintahan. This is how the gospel is going to be spread, right? Yeah. Because you're not going to give Bible studies to these people in there. What, you know? Apakah mereka nonton kita punya video? Oh, no, they're not going to do it. You know? Mereka itu waktu kita ditangkap, oh, baru mereka dengar. And then they're going to see, and they're going to ask you to defend your faith. Yeah. Jadi situ. That's how. And point yang the other point is, kalau kita lihat waktu midnight, at midnight, kamu sudah di seal. You're already sealed. Right? Jadi pemimpin-pemimpin yang akan ditangkap waktu midnight dituduh semua itu is actually a blessing because they will spread the gospel. And then the other thing is that, do they have to worry? No. Why? Because they're already sealed. Anything happen to them, they're in heaven. Kalau mereka mati, mereka masuk surga. They're already sealed. Ya, akan masuk surga. Ya. So it is not an issue that, you know, oh boy, somebody's gonna, ada bekas-bekas murid, istilahnya bekas murid ya. Kan Judas itu kan bekas murid. Ada bekas murid Judas. Ada Judas-Judas yang mau mengaduin mereka. Oh, Judas itu justru dipakai. He is actually used. It is the design, it is the actual plan. The plan is to have Judases so that the gospel can go to the government, to the higher ups, to the presidents and the rulers and the what? And the judges. Okay? That is the grand design. Itu udah desainnya begitu. Right? And the most important thing, if you're captured, you're golden. Because you're sealed.
For eternity.
Yeah, for eternity. Wow. Okay. All right. Anybody want to add something? Okay, I'm going to move on to another. What about Josiah Litch? All right. Josiah Litch. Oh, tunggu. Bukan ini. Sorry, not this one. Okay. All right. Josiah Litch. Anybody want to give a quick synopsis who Josiah Litch is? Ada yang mau, ini supaya saya mau. Siapa Josiah Litch? Who's Josiah Litch? Saya minum dulu. Siapa Josiah Litch? Ini Josiah Litch. What did he predict? Josiah Litch predict apa? What did Josiah Litch predict?
Empire.
Yeah, the fall of the Ottoman Empire. Okay, Nathan. Thank you, Natanya. The fall of the Ottoman Empire. Okay. All right. The fall of the Ottoman. No, it's not the fall until they're gone. No. The fall of their power. All right. Their ability to actually cause persecution to the Roman kingdom. Okay. That's what they can no longer attack the Roman kingdom, right? Mereka itu tidak punya kekuatan lagi untuk menyerang. Karena Ottoman Empire itu from the 1400 dari tahun 1400-an mereka itu cuma serang Rome aja. They keeps harassing Rome all the time, right? And Ottoman Empire is Islam. All they did was attack Rome, right? So in the prediction that was given by Josiah Litch, prediksi yang diberikan oleh Josiah Litch bahwa Ottoman Empire itu akan berhenti. No more. They're no more going to attack. They don't have any more power. All right? Okay. All right. Dia, okay, I'm not gonna read the whole thing karena kita udah banyak tahu ya. Dia berikan prediction. Dia terberikan tahun berapa dia berikan prediction ini? 1838. Tahun 1883. Dia pertama tulis. 1838. 1838. He wrote, right, that the Ottoman Empire is going to fall. Right? It's going to be overthrown. Their power is going to be overthrown. Right? Will end. Oh, okay. Yeah. Berdasarkan calculation untuk dari buku Revelation berapa? Revelation 9. Di Revelation 9 ada dua time prophecies. Satu 5 months, 150 hari, which is 150 tahun. Okay? Setelah itu hour, 15 days, day, year, and month. 30 years and a year, 360 years in all, 391 years and 15 days. Revelation 9. Ini mereka semua udah tahu nih. All of them know this one. Ada yang belum tahu ini? Do you have anybody haven't studied this before? Okay, I know it's you know, Nancy, I don't know Nan. Nan, have you studied this before, Nan?
No, not yet.
Okay.
But I mentioned it a little bit about Josiah Litch a couple of weeks ago.
Okay. All right. Gini, huh? All right. Okay. So I'm going to give this. Okay. All of you, you can bear with me as I give a quick synopsis. All right. Josiah, we'll see on another slide. Okay. Josiah Litch predict bahwa Revelation 9 ada dua time prophecy. 150 years. And then another one right after that, which is 391 years and 15 days, right? 391 years and 15 days. So 150 years followed by 391 days and 15 years. The yang hebatnya mereka bisa kalkulasi. They know exactly the beginning of the 150 years. Mereka tahu tepatnya tanggal berapa? July 29, right? They know exactly the beginning of that 150 years. And then when they put 100, then they count 150, and they count another 391 and 15. They said, okay, Josiah Litch, when we count that, you know, it's going to end in sometime in the month of August in 1840, right? Okay. Now, is this correct?
That is Islam.
Yeah. But this is the Ottoman Empire. Islam akan jatuh. Kekuatan mereka akan jatuh sometime in the month of August. All right? Now, he was a little vague. Right? He was kind of like hitting the... He was not hitting it the bullseye in the middle. Right? He had a big target. He was accurate, but he's not precise. Okay, enggak tepat tanggalnya. Jadi ballpark range he was correct, right? He said sometime in the month of August in 1840. When did he make that prediction? 1838, right? 1838. Okay, this is 606. This is the beginning of the fifth trumpet. The first woe. The 150 years. First woe, 150 years. Started in July 27, 1299. Okay? Mereka tahu ini. Karena di sini pertama kali Islam mulai serang kepada Rome. On that day, exactly on that day, July 27, 1299. Dan mereka tahu ini adalah 150 hari. 150 hari berarti itu 150 tahun. 150 years is, I mean, 150 days is 150 years. So they counted 150 years to 1449. Right? And after that, that's the sixth trumpet. You're going to have the sixth trumpet, and then you're going to have this 391 years and 15 days. Okay. 391 years and 15 days is a year, a month, a day, and a week. All right? 391 years and 15 days. When you put that all together, back to back, is going to end in 1840. Jadi mereka tahunya ini. Josiah Litch mengerti chiastic mirror. Remember chiastic mirror yang we did last time?
Yes.
He sees there's a chiastic mirror here. All right? He says, what goes up must come down here.
Yeah.
So he confidently knows that Islam who went up here is going to go down here.
Mm.
Okay? Itu karena dia tahu chiastic mirror, right? They see this chiastic mirror. You see this in prophecy. You know, when you study prophecy, you're going to see these chiastic mirrors. You say, I see this chiastic mirror. Jadi makanya mereka tahu, right? Right. And the other thing is they understand Ezekiel 4:6, because one day is 1 year. That's the day-year principle. The only way you can make that, if you 100, you know that it one day is 1 year. 150 days is 150 years. you have to understand the chiastic mirror, and you have to understand that one day is 1 year. Okay? And if those things are correct, then you will have the correct ending and the correct happening. You know, you're not going to say Ottoman Empire is going to rise or something else is going to rise. You say it's going to go down, and you know who's going to go down. Yeah, kamu tahu siapa yang akan jatuh. Yeah? Okay. Ini, this is from the Signs of the Times, June 1, 1840. This commentary was printed here, all right? And Litch wrote his commentary of his book that he was having it for sale. He was he's promoting his book, and this is what he's saying, you know, in his book. Jadi Josiah Litch, dia tulis dan dia promosi dia punya buku. Juni 1, 1840, alright. Padahal dia punya buku itu ditulis Mei 1840. Okay, jadi dia Mei 1840 dia ulangi lagi. Mei 1840 he repeated what he says again, right? The whole period will end in August 1840. Mereka bilangnya mulainya Juli 27, 1299. Jadi kalau dihitung akan akhirnya akan berakhir dalam bulan Agustus tahun 1840. Alright? Ini tahun he also wrote it in 1840. Tapi yang sebenarnya dia tulis ya di dalam, kalau kita baca dia punya Signs of the Times ini ya, dia juga tulis bulan Mei tahun 1840. So, Mei 1840. Lalu all right, and then in 1841 he also wrote it. No, sorry, he predicted it in 1841. But the thing about it is, this 1841 is actually waktu mereka categorize, lalu mereka print di dalam CD-ROM. Okay, but his actual date that he wrote this was in May 1840. Right, dia bilang akan terjadi August 1840. So a few months before May, June, July, August, 3 months before. Right, 3 months. Prediction. His prediction. He made it in May 1840. Right. Okay. This one was actually printed on August 1, 1840. Signs of the Times. It was printed in August 1, 1840. Allowing the first period, 150 years, to have been exactly fulfilled before Diakosis ascended the throne by permission of the Turks, and that the 391 years and 15 days commence at the close of the first period. Okay? The first period is 150 years. And then the 391-15 follows after that. It will end on. Now he's bold.
390 days.
Akan berakhir 11th of August 1840. Before he was saying it's in August of 1840. But now, 10 days ahead of time, 10 hari dicetak sebelum terjadi, he says it is going to happen on August 11, 1840. All right. Dan buktinya di sini. This is the proof. Right? This is the proof. Hebatnya Nyonya White dan kita punya pioneers quoted this this newspaper from London, right? They quoted this newspaper from London, and they claim that it, because what this newspaper said, it means that the prediction is correct. Okay, Nyonya White dan pionir-pionir kita mengutip dari koran ini yang ditulis di Inggris, because because the Ottoman Empire was fighting the Turks, was fighting the English, right? And the English wrote, orang-orang Inggris menulis begini ya, right? Yang hebatnya Leroy Froome. Leroy Froome dia pergi, dia cari copy dari koran ini di Library of Congress di Washington DC, dan dia bilang, saya sudah cari-cari, saya nggak bisa dapat. I cannot find that. Alright. Lalu ada juga A.T. Jones. A.T. Jones dia bilang dia pergi ke Inggris. Dia mau cari itu copy dari ini koran. Dia bilang kita nggak bisa dapat. You know, these people eventually apostatized. Dan mereka mau cari alasan bahwa sebenarnya koran ini sebenarnya tidak ada yang di-quote oleh Nyonya White dan pionir-pionir. You know, but when I went on the internet and looked it up in the archives, I found it. It's actually not difficult with internet, you know. Right. This is how she quoted it. Itu koran yang tadi, koran Nyonya White quote di Great Controversy 334. 2 years before 1840, 2 years before, Josiah Litch, one of the leading ministers preaching the Second Advent, published in the Exposition of Revelation 9, predicting the fall of the Ottoman Empire and specifying not only the year, but the very day in which this would take place. Right? Josiah Litch, 2 tahun sebelum tahun 1840, memberikan prediksi berdasarkan Revelation 9. Bahwa Ottoman Empire akan jatuh, bukan hanya tahunnya, tapi on the very day, tanggalnya pun dia sudah prediction. Tapi dia tahun 1838 dia prediksi bulan dan tahun, 10 hari sebelumnya dia prediksi tanggalnya yang tepat, right? At the very time, Turkey through her ambassadors accepted the protection of the Allied powers of Europe, and thus place herself under the control of Christian nations. Turkey sekarang sudah memberikan powernya kepada negara-negara Eropa. Dan negara Eropa boleh control Turkey sekarang. So now they gave up the power. Right? When it became known, multitudes were convinced of the correctness of the principles of prophetic interpretation. Dan sekarang orang-orang tahu the method of interpretation used by the Millerites, metode yang dipakai oleh pengikutnya Miller adalah correct. Metodenya apa? What was the method? What was the method? Jadi mereka bilang, okay, metodenya betul. What was the method? The day-year principle. Betul? The day-year principle. Itu, it vindicated the Budaya principle, but also the chiastic mirror, right? The chiastic mirror was vindicated there. The day-year principle and the chiastic mirror was vindicated. Bahwa itu betul. That's correct. Without knowing that principle, tanpa mengetahui prinsip-prinsip itu, pengikutnya William Miller tidak bisa memberikan prediction. Then what happened? The prophetic principles, the principles of prophetic interpretation adopted by Miller and his associates, and a wonderful impetus was given to the Advent movement. A wonder impetus. Jadi, prediction yang diberikan itu membuat impetus. Impetus ini apa bahasa Indonesianya? became a wonderful impetus. Bahasa Indonesia apanya? What does impetus mean? Kali ini empowerment. Sebenarnya impetus itu empowerment. Jadi memberikan kekuatan, to give the power. Okay? So what were they pada waktu itu? Dorongan ya, dorongan betul. Dorongan atau memberikan kekuatan, you know. Which angel's message was they proclaiming in 1840? Which angel's message were they proclaiming in 1840? Starting in 1798. Mulai tahun 1798. Which angel's message? Which angel's message? It's easy. The first angel's message, starting in 1798. But now, Ellen White said, when they made this prediction, there was a wonderful impetus. There was an empowerment to the message. In other words, dan kata lain, first angel's message is empowered. Jadi, tahun 1798, first angel's message dikasih. All right? Because that's the time of the end. Itu adalah time of the end. Right? 1798. Lalu nanti, on August 11, 1840, is when the message is empowered. Message-nya di-empower. Diberikan kekuasaan. Okay? So you give the message, but the people don't, you know, they don't respond to the message that well. But when they see the power behind it, wow, something happens. You know? Something happens. There's a power that's given to the message. Wow, orang bangun. Right? So the first angel's message is given, and then there's an empowerment of that angel's message. Okay? And the empowerment is the fulfillment of prophecy. Ottoman jatuh. Islam jatuh. Okay? Okay, ada pertanyaan? Anybody wants to give a comment? You know, this is not ini supaya kita tahu nih. And we know this happens at midnight. Dan ini akan terjadinya waktu midnight. Okay. At 1838. Ini 1838 ini penting juga nih. Tahun 1838 itu hal penting. Karena tahun 1838 menurut Uriah Smith, dunia itu sedang bergelojak. The world was in turmoil. There was a distress of nations. Ini bahasa Alkitab ini. There was a distress of nations. Because everybody's fighting each other. There was a distress of nations. When there's a distress of nations, what happens? The kings are afraid. Right? The kings are afraid. And kita tahu dari Mazmur 48, when the kings are afraid, they are afraid of what? The east wind. Because there's something happens with the east wind, you know. Always something else happened. There's a distress of nations. Always something to do with Islam. Sorry. There's the... In 1838, Turkey became involved in a war with Egypt, and Egyptians bid fair to overthrow the Turkish power. To prevent this, the four great powers of Europe, England, Russia, and Austria, and Prussia interfered. Right? Ini waktu zaman mereka tahun 1838 is called the Eastern Question. Eastern Question ini the problem that is happening in the East. You know, this is the problem is about Islam. You know, the Eastern Question. You know, the East Wind. The Eastern Question. Ini zaman mereka aja mereka udah bilang Islam punya problem is an Eastern Question. Bayangin zaman dulu they call this Islamic problem. The Eastern Question. It was an Eastern question. So this it causes a distress of nations, right? In 1838. Yeah? Okay. All right. So I'm just gonna keep going. Okay. All right. Yeah, Uriah Smith said that. Okay. First prediction. Prediksi yang pertama bilang sometime in August 1840. Yeah, dia bilang sometime. Nah, somewhere, sometime in August 1840. He made it in tahun 1838. That's his first prediction. His second prediction, it will end in 1840. Kayaknya udah lebih confident ini. Ini kayaknya kurang confident ya. Sometime in August 1840. This one he says, it will end in August 1840. Now he wrote this in May 1840. This is 2 years before. This is May, June, July, August. 3 months before. All right? The third prediction. It will end in the 11th of August. So the third prediction happens in August 1840. Nah, kalau kita lihat jatuhnya. Jadi first, ini August 11, 1840. Ini 1838. Ini August 1, 1840. Right? This is 391 years. Akhirnya, 391 years, ini akhirnya berhentinya di sini. Okay? Right. Okay. The obligate prediction-nya, when we put it on the line, waktu midnight. Right? And he makes three predictions. Kita ingat kalau kita belajar Mara Vision, berapa kali Daniel di touch? 3 kali. Between midnight and the midnight cry for a priest. Right? Here he makes three predictions between midnight and midnight cry. Right? Three predictions. And then it comes true. Right? Apa hubungannya? What is the application for us? Jadi waktu midnight, waktu ditangkap, we're gonna make a prediction. And it says, hey, what are you preaching? And you're gonna make a prediction. And your prediction is what? Dari lihat aja sini. It's gonna be Islam, right? Tapi bukannya Islam fall, we know. Ini bukan Islam fall here. Because we know from our studies, this is exactly what is going to happen to America when Islam attacks. So we know, Dini, our prediction at midnight has something to do with Islam. And we are going to make that prediction that Islam is going to attack America and the economy of America is going to fall. And apa yang terjadi? When it happens, it's going to give an impetus to the message. Jadi orang-orang akan percaya. Nah, jadi orang yang percaya itu bangun semua. Wow. Kamu benar juga ya apa kamu bilang. That's how it's going to be impetus and give empowerment. All right. In 1838, he predict 1840. All right. Okay. All right. Ada
prof.
Ya.
Yang prediction ini nanti apa? Priest akan bikin prediction sesudah diseal.
Oh yeah, have to be. Oh,
okay.
Have to be. Gak bisa. Ingat. Okay, ini nanti kalau kita belajar tentang Mara, ya, Mara Vision. This is what I'm also leading up to Mara Vision. Because for you to be given a restoration of the spirits of prophecy. Ya. Kamu bisa bikin prophecy? You know, can we actually have prophecy? We don't have a prophet since 1915, right? But the spirit of prophecy will be restored to those who are sealed, right? To the church triumphant. You are the church triumphant here already. This is the beginning of the church triumphant starts here. Then the people will start joining here. Join church triumphant. You are sealed. Those who are sealed will be given the restoration of the spirit of prophecy. In other words, they can prophesy. You know, when you give a prediction, what are you doing? you're prophesying, right? Yeah. So you are given the spirit of prophecy. You know, you have to be sealed to be given that. We can't, you know, we can give a prediction, but we can't give a prophecy right now. Ya, kita sudah harus bikin ini gereja triumphant. Church triumphant bahasa Indonesianya ada ya? Diterjemahkannya ada nggak ya? Ada church triumphant, church yang udah menang. Ya, the church triumphant has to be. You have to be sealed, and that's why it's comforting to know if you're actually arrested here, you're sealed. Sebenarnya harus seneng kalau kamu ditangkap karena kamu sudah diseal. Right? And when you're sealed spiritually and intellectually. Intellectually, because you know chiastic mirror, you know the year principle, you know mare and Chalcedon Vision semua. That's why you can give this prediction. Dan akhir dan betul prediksinya. And it gives an impetus to the message, right? Kekuatan message. Okay. Ada lagi? All right. Any next? Okay. 38 and 40. 38 dan 40. What is 38 and 40? The number nomor 38 itu ditulis 4 kali dalam Alkitab. If you look for 38, is mentioned only 4 times in the Bible. Okay? Only 4 times in the Bible. Right? We're gonna see this. Cari. Gampang sebenarnya. Just go to Esword and then look at 38. Okay. In the book of Deuteronomy 2 verse 13 to 18. Now rise up. Oh, rise up. Remember? Rise up. Ingat Musa, rise up and tell the Pharaoh what's going to happen.
Bangun.
Dan kamu harus kasih tahu Pharaoh the number, the fourth plague. The third plague happens at midnight. Okay. Rise up, all right? Get you over the brook Zered. And he went over the brook Zered and the space in which we came from Kadesh Barnea until we were come over the brook Zered was 38 years. Okay. Jadi, you know, rise up and then you have to come back to the Kadesh Barnea. All right? You have to, kamu harus kembali ke Kadesh Barnea. What happened in Kadesh Barnea? Kita harus kembali lagi ke tempat itu, Kadesh Barnea. It's 38 years until all the generation of the men of war were wasted out from among the host. Artinya apa? Orang-orang yang bersungut-sungut, yang tidak percaya bahwa mereka itu bisa menang untuk masuk ke tanah Kanaan. Mereka itu percaya kepada the 10 spies. Mereka percaya kepada 10 mata-mata. Ya. Mereka itu harus mati semua. They all have to die in the wilderness. How many years ago? 38 tahun lalu. Right? Jadi 2 tahun mereka sampai di Kadesh Barnea, itu mata-mata masuk, mereka nggak bisa ini, mereka bilang kita nggak bisa masuk Kanaan, jadi mereka harus muter-muter. Muter-muternya harus berapa tahun? How many years total did they have to go in the wilderness? Mengembara. 40 tahun. But 40 years wandering in the wilderness is actually the 38th year since Kadesh Barnea. See? Do you see that? 38 tahun setelah mereka dulu di Kadesh Barnea, mereka kembali lagi di Kadesh Barnea, itulah tahun ke-40 sejak mereka keluar dari Mesir. So 38 is actually 40. Ah, hebat sekali ya. pretty amazing. So what happens? 38, the generation of men of war are wasted out among the host. Di situ orang yang tidak percaya dipisahkan. Isn't there a separation at midnight? Yeah? Isn't there a special servant? Yeah? Who was separated at midnight? Oh, Judas. Judas was separated at midnight. Who was also separated at the 38th year? The generation of the men of war. They were also separated at 38. And 38 is 40, right? Josiah Litch predicted in the year 38, he was predicting the year 1840. 38 in the 38 is 40, right? Yeah, Deuteronomy 1:3. They came past in the 40th year, right? Okay, anybody have a question? Ah, ada yang kamu pertanyaan? Apa bisa kita pakai tahun-tahun dalam tahun kalender? Istilahnya tahun kalender ini tahun-tahun, you know, this is not a Gregorian calendar. Well, this is a Gregorian calendar. Tapi kita bisa pakai tahun-tahun 38, tahun 40 gitu. Apa kita bisa masukkan, apakah kita ada hak untuk masukkan itu ke dalam prophecy? You know, is it, do we have the prophetic license to do that? Do you think it's a, too much of a stretch? Apakah itu terlalu, wah ini kita kayak presumptuous sekali ya, berani sekali kita bilang. Bahwa kita bisa pakai tahun-tahun begini, kita bisa masukkan dalam prophecy. You know what? You know, God has a way of teaching us. You know? You can use all these numbers. You can see it. If you can see it, and it fits perfectly, wow. All right. Ah, kita tahu di sini ya? Numbers 14, verse 33 and 35. For your children shall wander in the wilderness 40 years and bear your whoredoms until their carcasses be wasted in the wilderness. In the number of days in which ye search the land, even 40 days. Each day for a year. Jadi, bukannya Josiah Litch pada waktu dia meramalkan, dia memakai a day for a year principle. Dan ini juga a day for a year principle. Numbers 14:33. Numbers 14:34. Bahwa kamu yang tadinya mata-mata mencari 40 tahun di Kanaan, karena kamu tidak percaya, kamu harus mengembara 40 hari, makanya kamu harus mengembara 40 tahun. A day year principle. Jadi day year principle dipakai di dalam prinsip Kadesh Barnea juga. Alright? Okay. Alright, di Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 2:24-25. Rise ye up and take your journey and pass over the river Arnon. Behold, I have given unto thee thine hand Sihon the Amorite. Eh, hey, ini bangsa Amorite. Right? Ini waktu mereka udah mau masuk Kanaan. Karena mereka harus mengalahkan Bani Amorite. Ya. Kapan Amorite itu mereka ketemu? Sama Amorite. Siapa yang pertama ketemu bangsa Amorite? Kita ingat dari minggu lalu belajar. Who was the first one? Right. That is not Amalek. This is Amorite. Abraham. Abraham had a friend that went and helped him rescue Lot. Remember? It was an Amorite.
Oh.
Right. Okay, but anyway, this is when they went back. And they went sebelum masuk ke Kanaan. And he said, begin to possess it and contend with him in the battle. This day will I begin to put the dread of thee and the fear of thee upon the nations that under the whole heaven, who shall hear a report of thee and shall tremble and be in anguish because of thee. Jadi dari hari itu, waktu kamu sudah akan masuk ke Kanaan, you know, at the end of 38, at the end of 40, at the end of 38 and 40, pada hari itu, kamu akan ditakuti. And there's going to be the fear of nations. Okay? Mereka akan takut. Bangsa-bangsa akan takut kepada kamu. And they will start to tremble. Why? The kings are going to start to tremble. And remember, they always tremble because of the east wind. And then what kind of prediction do you give? It's about Islam. And what's going to happen to them? The kings are going to tremble. Negara-negara, I will put the dread of thee. Saya akan memberikan ketakutan kepadamu di dalam bangsa-bangsa. When you give your prediction. Yeah. Bangsa-bangsa akan takut kepada kamu. Okay? All right. 38. Ada lagi 38. Remember 38 di Bethesda? Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool. Dekat sheep market ada kolam, which is in the Hebrew called Bethesda, having 5 porches. Right? In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, blind, halted, wilted, waiting for the moving of the water. Oh, there's a moving of the waters. Moving of the waters is what? Troubling of the nations. Right? Remember Uriah Smith bilang, tahun berapa terjadi distress of the nations? 1838. The Bethesda is a moving of the waters, a troubling of the nations. For an angel went down in a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Yeah, troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after touching the water, stepped in was made whole, whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity, how many years? Penyakitnya berapa tahun? 38 years. They know. When Jesus saw him lie, he knew that he had been now a long time in that case. And he said unto them, wilt thou be made whole? What? And then with that, lalu dia, rise up. There's a rising up. Ini lihat ini. Rise up. And rise up. Semua di midnight, there's going to be a midnight cry. There's going to be a rising up. Rising up. Musa, rise up. What? Yang tadi, kita, the priest have to rise up. Midnight, semua. There's going to be midnight cry. There's going to be rising up. Take up thy bed and walk. Immediately the man was made whole. Okay. Tapi kita teruskan. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more. He says, jangan lagi berdosa. Don't sin anymore. Right. From midnight to midnight cry, there's no more sinning. Right? And the man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus. Ini? At the 38th year of this man, dia punya kesakitan 38 tahun, Tuhan Yesus bilang, jangan kamu berdosa lagi. And then they persecute Jesus. And why did they persecute Jesus? And they sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Oh, dia melanggar hari Sabat. Wow. But Jesus answered them, my Father worketh here too, and I work. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he had not only broken the Sabbath, but he said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. So at the 38th year of this man, tahun ke-38 kesakitan manusia ini, apa terjadi? Tuhan Yesus dipersecute dan disangkalkan dia punya his keilahiannya, his sonship. You know, they question his sonship. Okay. Ada anybody have any questions? Ini udah dua.
Cukup.
Ya. Ya, kita sampai di sini aja dulu ya. Oh, there's a lot of so we see kita bisa lihat 38 dengan midnight. Right? The sonship of God is questioned. Jesus is arrested. Jesus was persecuted. There's a troubling of the waters. The stress of nations. And the dread of nations it put into you. Nations akan takut kepada kamu. All this happens midnight to midnight cry. All right? Okay. All right. Anybody have any tambahan? All right. Any questions? All right. Ini semua tentang midnight. All right. A lot of information. Kita bisa tahu. We know what is going to happen. Right. There's a lot more. Kita tahu. There's a lot, masih ada lagi ya, you know. We'll kita sambungin lagi nanti sedikit lagi and hope to go into Daniel 10. Okay. So the summary is at midnight. You're gonna the arrest of the priest. The true priest is gonna be arrested. Is gonna be betrayed by the false prophet, be taken to the beast, who will then take them to the dragon. Accuse the true priest of profanation, sedition, and blasphemy. No, first profanation, then blasphemy. And then sedition. Lalu seditionnya itu membuat aliran sendiri. Something to do with taxes. Exact detailnya nggak tahu ya. We're not really sure. But there's something to do with that too. And then you're gonna make a prediction, just like Josiah Litch. Something about Islam. We know that we know exactly what it's gonna be because it's. Islam is going to be attacked and America's economy is going to fall. It has also do, and then with that prediction, kamu akan ditakuti oleh, you're going to be, the dread of nations is going to come you. There's going to be a distress of nations because everybody's going to be worried about Islam all the time, at that time, because it happens, right? And then the reason why you're accused of blasphemy is because your belief in the sonship of Jesus, the Son of God. Okay? That's 38:40. 38:40 is 38 is midnight, right? 38 and 38 is 40, right? Because 38th year of them from Kadesh Barnea is the 40th year. And on that time, God will give the dread of nations to you. Okay. All right. Okay.